And it's Kevin Willmott, the director of the 24th and the screenwriter. Congratulations on another terrific movie.
Oh, thank you guys. Appreciate it.
I'd like to know, you know, this is a historic film. Tell us a little bit about what it's about and how you think it will resonate with contemporary audiences.
Well, you know, I stumbled on a photograph, the photograph of that incident. I stumbled on this photograph probably 30 years ago now. And I wrote the original script a long time ago. And it's about the Houston riot of 1917. And when I saw this photograph, it said the largest murder trial in American history. And I had never heard anything about it. I'm kind of a history geek. I never heard anything about it. And I was just fascinated, researched it, and really kind of found this amazing story. And so really kind of fictionalized it in terms of the character development and turned it into a movie, but really kept the core facts of that surrounded the actual rebellion riot that happened. And I hope it will really speak to people today. I mean, obviously, in the wake of George Floyd's murder, I think it's a reminder that this has been going on a long time. You know, 103 years ago, this incident happened. And it just lets you know that one bad policeman, you know, 103 years ago could destroy a community and rock a nation just like one did this year. And, you know, the more things change, the more they stay the same.
I want to ask you this, Kevin. I don't think I've talked to you personally since you won the Oscar for being a co-screenwriter for The Black Klansman. And I want to find out from you, how has that changed your life? And where were you in the process of getting this film done when you actually won the award?
You know, I actually wrote this with Trey Byers. We kind of rewrote my original script while I was working on Black Klansman. And when Black Klansman happened and we won the award, the script was finished. And so we kind of leveraged that to make this film, really, I think. In the wake of the energy and excitement of all that, yeah, I think it helped really make this film. And originally, my agent, when I wrote it a long time ago, my agent said, no one will ever make this film. Mm. And I think it's a testament that things have improved some. I think America's kind of ready for this movie now, I'd like to believe. I think America can understand this movie a lot more now than maybe it could a few years ago. So I'm anxious to see kind of what's going to happen.
It's sort of a testament to the power of movies that it took a Showtime series to make people aware of the Tulsa massacre. And now we have a movie that's going to make people aware of what happened in Houston. You when you make these films that are based on true stories, but you have to change things around to make it more palatable maybe for movie audiences, how did you change this film and what was true and what wasn't?
Sure. Well, the real incident revolved around kind of what you see in the film. The Trey Byers character is based on a guy by the name of Baltimore. And Baltimore was this beloved guy within the 24th. And what we kind of gave Boston was a whole backstory that didn't exist in the real Baltimore. And so, you know, we kind of created a backstory that based in he's kind of a guy who's been influenced by W.B. Du Bois and the Talented 10%. And blacks at this time who had gotten educations or maybe were well off in some kind of way. They had this idea that they should go back and help the struggling 90% of blacks who were still fighting discrimination and poverty, and so that's the big development that you know that where we gave him a life that probably did not exist with the real Baltimore, and of course and a romance as well that you know was not based on anything that historically that we knew. But everything else is pretty correctly based in what's known as the Houston riot of 1917. And the other characters in the film are all based on people that would have had these kind of, you know, would have come from the environments they come from in the film.
Wow. Congrats. Well, people are primarily finding out about you on a national stage as a screenwriter, but you've been making movies for a long time. This is movie number what for you?
I think this is like 8 for me. I think this is my eighth feature film. Yeah. And, you know, it's interesting because we shot this movie in 18 days. And even though this is probably the biggest budget movie I've ever made, I had to employ some of my low budget techniques to stay on that schedule. And those low budget techniques, you know, they always come in handy even when you get a budget. And they especially come in handy. I always tell my students this, you know, it's not so much money about money, it's more about time. Time is the real thing you want when you're making a film. And so when you have limited time, you really gotta know what you want to do. You gotta really have your vision together.
Now, yeah, 18 days. A lot of people don't realize that 18 days is quick, so we gotta put that in context. Like
18 days is quick.
That's quick.
I mean, you know, there was a lot of shooting at night, and there's
that's quick.
You know, there's a lot of stuff. It's got a lot of dialogue, but it's got a lot of action in this movie too. So, and it's a period piece that always slows you down as well.
Yeah, that's a lot of work.
The movie features a couple of actors that you've worked with before. You mentioned Trey Byers, who was your co-screenwriter, and also the Tosin Monhunfula, I hope I pronounced that right.
Yeah, Monhunfula, yeah.
Who was in Destination Planet Negro with you back in 2013. Is there any other of your old clan?
Yeah, sure. Joseph Anderson, who was also in Jayhawkers, is in it as well.
Okay.
And if I could have got all my guys in it, I would have. But we shot it in Charlotte and Concord, North Carolina, which really worked out well. But there were certain stipulations there where I couldn't use certain actors. You had to be from the Atlanta area and that kind of thing. So, but yeah, you know, Trey, you know, was a former student of mine. Tosin was a former student of mine at KU. And it's always great to work with guys that you know and love.
Let's talk about the elephant in the room. We haven't really addressed this. We're still in the middle of a pandemic. You're a filmmaker, you're creative. Every filmmaker wants eyeballs on their work, and you want the eyeballs to happen at a movie theater. How crushing is it to you as a filmmaker that you're dealing with a situation of releasing a film during the pandemic?
Well, it definitely hurts, no doubt about it. I think I think the Five Bloods helped me to kind of get used to it, the whole notion that, you know, that this is the way it is right now. And I've seen other filmmakers, you know, release films and you know, it's you have to watch it on your television, and that's just kind of the way it is. And I think it probably South by Southwest being canceled probably prepared me for all this, because it's kind of, that's just been the reality for a while now. And I've heard some people that have seen the film that really like it, and they talked about how it would have been to see it on the big screen. There's that thing you get from an audience that is, you just can't, when you're in the theater, that, you know, you just can't describe. It's just a beautiful thing. And that vibe you get from the audience, you know, it's nothing replaces that. So, but I'm hoping people find the film and really enjoy it and respond to it.
I've heard other filmmakers talk about the fact that they would have made the movie differently had they known it was going to pop up on TV instead of the big screen. So I'm asking you, would you have approached anything differently with this film had you known about this release?
No, I don't think so. Our film, I try to make my films, whatever they are, smaller budget or larger budget film like this, I try to make them with the same vision. I mean, whether it's, I don't think a lot about how it's going to be perceived. You try in the writing and the vision of direction, you try to offer a film that comes from you and your heart and your conscience and all of those things. And you kind of, it's out of your hands at that point, really. You know, it's, you just hope that you've done something well and that people connect to it.
You've touched on a lot of issues that are really relevant right now in today's society in terms of racial inequality, social injustice, and a lot of your films have touched on that. How much of a response have you gotten on your back catalog, particularly Confederate States of America?
Yeah, well, that film just keeps on becoming more and more relevant, unfortunately. I'd like to be wrong about this film. But it's, literally, we're kind of living through, the third act of my movie right now, really. And, I like the fact that my films often connect that way. I mean, I'm not trying to do that, but I am trying to connect with our real history and our real problems and the realities of our lives. So in that sense, it's a compliment, really, I guess. But you hope that my films stop being so relevant.
No, we don't. No. We want all your movies to stand the test of time. That's why I'm so excited about the 24th.
That's right. And as we laugh at it. It is what it is. But I think a large part of it is when you are trying to make a film about who we are and about who we've been and where we're trying to go, I think it always speaks to the day in some kind of way.
One thing that I've noticed in watching this film is that there is an underlying Kevin Willmott sense of humor that you've brought to all your films. And that even though this is a really serious and could potentially be very depressing topic, it's never not engaging.
Yeah, that's the real trick when you deal with something this serious, and something this serious on this kind of scale of emotion, really. I think that even in the most deadly moments of our lives, we find humor, and my humor kind of comes out of being serious, really. I really don't tell jokes so much as I respond humorously to dramatic, political, dramatic, whatever kind of situations, and I think audiences like that. I think that connects with audiences in a real way. I think Tosin's character, specifically in the film, Walker, I think he's the guy I'm kind of using to do that a lot of times in the film, and it was great to work with Tosin in that way because I think Tosin's got a real natural comedic sense and timing and so it was just great to employ that in the movie.
So now that you got the 24th in the can and it's about to open to the world, which by the way, it is showing on some screens theatrically, so it's not a straight to VOD release. You can watch it in some locations on the big screen, just not as many as back in the day, but that option is still available. But during this pandemic, what's next for you as a filmmaker? What's next for you as a professor? How has the world changed for you and how are you moving forward?
Yeah, well, I'm working right now on an Arthur Ashe biopic and I'm hoping to finish that soon and really excited about that. I mean, I'm really honored to be telling his story. I mean, his story is a very important story and people don't know it very well. And so in that sense, I'm really looking forward to that. I hope it gets to move forward and becomes a film. I've been working, I have a script from the play I wrote about Martin Luther King's young life. And I'm in talks now about turning that into some, hopefully maybe something kind of major. So kind of keep your eyes on another documentary that about gay life in Kansas that we're editing now and I think it's going to be a really fine, important film. I really love those stories about activism on the outside of New York and LA, because I think when you're an activist in a small town, you really have to pay personally for your beliefs and what you're trying to do And that documentary is going to reflect that.
Is there a silver lining, perhaps, to the fact that this film is going to be shown on VOD so that maybe more people could see it than during a theatrical release?
You know, that's the thing that I think I kind of learned from The Five Bloods. I mean, obviously, it was on Netflix, but I think people probably saw that movie more on Netflix than they would have in the theater. And I may be wrong about that, but I think, you know, I mean, guys like us who love film, you know, the theater's our thing, you know? But I think a lot of regular folks, you know, they don't get to the theater like they should. And the pandemic obviously has knocked that out now. So I'm hoping that, you know, that maybe more people will see it this way than maybe would have actually maybe seen it in theaters.
Yeah, that's a great point. And I guess one of the final things I would like to ask you, because I know this question gets asked a lot from me, when can you make something happen locally where you actually bring film production to the KC metro area? Is it even possible? Is it something you think about?
I think about it all the time. I would have loved to have shot the 24th in Kansas City. And I tried to get a shot here. Unfortunately, it's all about those tax incentives. It's all one thing, tax incentive. If Kansas City could have competed with the tax incentive of North Carolina, we would have shot in Kansas City. Simple as that.
Comes down to the money.
It's all about the money and the financiers. You know, for them, it's all one thing, the money. And they're not going to let you shoot it in a place where they get less money back. They're just not going to do that.
Okay, now the really important question. Where does your Oscar live?
I should have it behind me here somewhere.
You should. Hey, come on.
I know, man. You know, I got a BAFTA too, man. So the BAFTA.
That's right. You got.
The BAFTA's pretty cool too, man. I've got it downstairs in my screening room, and so I got a little nice little cabinet thing. It's pretty cool.
Now the actual real most important question: what was the craziest party you went to while you were campaigning?
You know, I tell you, man. I think there was one. They were all a little crazy, but you know, most of them were kind of serious too, because they always had Spike, you know, talk about the film and he'd bring me in to talk about it. So in that sense, we were always pretty, you know, driven, you know, we're selling hard this thing we're trying to sell here. So in that sense, it was always cool. It was a lot of fun.
Did you realize it was so intense?
You know, you told me about this because
I said your life would change.
Yeah, you told me that if you guys get nominated, there's this whole campaign you go on, and yeah, I mean, I got to places I had never seen and would have never met before, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I mean, it was a job. It really is a job, but it was a great job.
Well, man, we couldn't be more proud of you, man. I'm just glad you're able to keep creating. That's a beautiful thing. And you have cranked out another, I mean, you got it, man. You've cranked out another fantastic film. So whatever we can do to support, man, and sing his praises, it really is a film worthy of being seen.
Well, you know, I really, truly appreciate that, man. And, you know, I feel very fortunate to have been able to do my thing here, you know, in Kansas City and Lawrence. I mean, it's, you know, I love New York, I love LA, but this is home for me, and it's a lot easier for me to do my thing here, so I truly appreciate that.
No, no worries.
Thanks again. Good on you, man. We appreciate it.
Yeah, hey. Thanks for your time, Kevin, man. No, seriously, man, we're proud of you, man. This movie's great, and whoever designed the poster, man, that's a killer poster.
That's a killer poster, man. I was killer. So pleased with that poster.
I need to get one and get it framed, man. That is a dope poster. That poster is amazing. That's where it starts, though. That's
I know. It's where it starts. That's right.
It starts. That right. Poster is dope, that's man. Right. They did a no great doubt. Job with that. Yeah, so.
Yeah, for sure, man. For
yeah,
sure.
Congratulations. Keep working hard. Right, I read about Arthur Ashe, man. Get that one done, man. That couldn't get done fast enough. We need that one.
I know,
one.
Man. I'm hoping that happens, for sure.
Okay. Congrats.
But thanks, guys. Right, be safe, man.
Anything else, Russ?